It's great to have people here on a Friday to talk about an event of really great importance, which I don't feel had enough attention in the media. I had the pleasure of being at COP 22 in Marrakesh in November, and while I was there, had a chance to meet with Tzeporah. I knew Jennifer was somewhere in the bowels of the negotiations, following very closely what was happening. And at the end of that week, I came and said, no, this really, there's so much going on here. It needs to be communicated back to an interested public audience here in Vancouver. And quite frankly, not only Canadians were very strongly represented, people from this city were strongly represented. So I was delighted that both Tzeporah and Jennifer Allan were able to join us today. I'll introduce them in a second. We'll start by thanking our sponsors, as we always do. We're very grateful for the continuing support of the North Growth Foundation for the program of Carbon Talks and the Pacific Institute for Climate Solutions, which enables us to both live stream these events, so there is an audience that's not in the room, but across the province and maybe beyond, who are following and are certainly welcome to contribute questions and comments to this event. And I'll just speak to that now. Questions should be sent to @CarbonTalks on Twitter, or you can follow the conversation with @CarbonTalks. And we do take questions coming in from our remote audience and, of course, from all of you in the room. So what we'll do is, this runs for an hour. We end at 1:30 sharp. Each of our presenters will be asked to speak for up to 10 minutes. I'm going to invite them to have a little bit of an exchange between each other, and then we'll open it up for comments and questions from everybody in the room and online. As I usually do, I forget to introduce myself, so I'll correct that. I'm Michael Small, and I'm the Executive Director of Carbon Talks and Renewable Cities here at SFU. And I'll now properly introduce our two speakers. So to go first will be Jennifer Allan on my left. Jennifer is a doctoral candidate at the University of British Columbia, and she's a team leader for the Earth Negotiations Bulletin, which is the reporting document of record for all international environmental negotiations. And she was present at COP22 in that capacity. The Earth Negotiations Bulletin is a project of the International Institute of Sustainable Development, based here in Canada, but an international organization. And our second speaker, Jennifer, will speak to the official negotiations process, which she followed. And our second speaker, probably well known to many people here in Vancouver, is Tzeporah Berman, who's an environmental activist, writer, adjunct professor at York University, and significantly a global ambassador for the 100% Renewable Energy Campaign. And in that capacity, she moderated a quite remarkable gathering in Marrakesh, which our program, Renewable Cities, was happy to be one of the many co-sponsors. So with no further ado, I'll start with Jennifer. Maybe you can tell us what people should know about what happened at COP22.
Thank you, and thanks to everyone coming, especially in a snowpocalypse, which I'm from Prince George, so it's just called snow. But it's lovely to see so many people braved it to come out. So the COP, as we call it, the Conference of the Parties, it's an annual get-together of countries and international organizations and NGOs and activists. It's sort of a coral reef of activity. And the core bit that I tend to follow closely is the negotiations. So interstate negotiations, what countries are doing to try to come up with global policies to address climate change. Now, last year, this was a really big deal. Last year was Paris, you know, when there was a deadline to agree to a new agreement that will reduce emissions, that will help countries adapt to the changes that we're already seeing of climate change, that will provide finance for developing countries to both reduce their emissions and to adapt to these changes. And I think I sat in this room before going to Paris saying, 50-50 shot, that they'll agree to something. And luckily, I was proved wrong, or half wrong. So last year, we have a Paris Agreement, and it was adopted. And then we had 2016, which was a rather remarkable year for international climate governance. We had the Paris Agreement enter into force, which means that more than 50 countries took that agreement home and passed domestic laws saying we agree to be held or bound by this agreement. And those 50 countries, or more than 50 countries, represented more than 55% of global emissions. And those were the two thresholds for the agreement to enter into force. So the agreement entered into force faster than any other international treaty ever has. it's a remarkable amount of momentum that went into that. I did hear rumors that in part it was to help Trump-proof the global climate regime. On top of that, we also had an international agreement to reduce hydrofluorocarbons. So HFCs are more powerful than the dreaded carbon dioxide that we all focus on. And there was an agreement under the Montreal Protocol to reduce these emissions. The international aviation sector agreed to an offset market-based mechanism to help not necessarily reduce their emissions, but offset their emissions. So it was, that was all 1 year. Actually, most of that was all 1 month. So climate governance came a long way in a very short amount of time. From people thinking this was going to fail before Paris, or there was a shot at failure or a very weak agreement, to a stronger agreement than many expected that was in force and coupled with private sector and other international organizations also taking climate action. So all of this was right before we headed into the next sort of meeting of the coral reef, the COP process. And so there was big expectations to show that the UN process can live up to this momentum. That was the first expectation, and that's a big one. You know, what can this traditionally slow-moving bureaucratic beast do to prove to the world we're up to the task? Especially since their actual task on their agenda of what they had to be working on was technical. So they had to be looking at rules, because the Paris Agreement has great sentences in it, like countries will mobilize or continue to mobilize finance. They don't say what counts as climate finance. They don't say what countries necessarily. They don't say to who, by what criteria. Or countries will have a common reporting framework. That's it. So what is that reporting framework? What will they be doing? So all of these technical details and rules is what now the UN process is trying to negotiate. And so those were the two sort of very different tasks leading into this COP. One, show that we can keep up this global momentum for climate action, and two, actually start progressing on very technical operational rules. So in the first case, the Moroccan presidency was very keen to show that they could help provide more momentum. There were a number of high-level events that brought together ministers, heads of state, business leaders. There were a lot of announcements of new funding, but most of that was actually happening in the civil society and in the side event space where Tzeporah was. And then these actually became more important after a certain election happened. And so in the middle of this meeting was when the US election occurred. So everyone went to bed in Morocco thinking that they would wake up to President-elect Clinton, and then everyone woke up to very different news. And so that left a lot of questions in the negotiations. So what is the future of a global climate agreement if the US isn't on board? And the only answer that we have to, based on history, is the Kyoto Protocol. Because shortly after the Kyoto Protocol was signed by President Clinton, President Bush announced that they would not be ratifying it. And so a lot of people were having sort of flashbacks to Kyoto. It didn't help they were in Morocco, where they also negotiated the operational rule book to the Kyoto Protocol. And so there was a lot of similarities and differences being drawn. And I think the largest message that I kept hearing come up was that the world is very different than it was 15 years ago. So the US is no longer the world's largest emitter on a per capita or on an absolute level. There are other very large emitters, including China, including the EU, who have already signed on and ratified this agreement. So before, it was sort of a naive statement to say the world will go on without you, US. Today it's not. So today, the world can move on without the US potentially. There was also a lot of people making sure that it was known that indeed the Paris Agreement to some extent is Trump-proof. There is a 3-year waiting period. So if a country wants to withdraw from the Paris Agreement, they send their intention to withdraw. There's a bit of a processing wait period there. And then there's a legal 3-year waiting period. So essentially, it would take the length of an administration. And this isn't sort of conjecture. Todd Stern, the former head of the U.S. delegation, wrote in the Washington Post that the Paris Agreement is effectively Trump-proof. There are ways around that, of course. But that was very much in the mind that there would be a U.S. election shortly after the Paris Agreement was adopted. And so there was, especially at the COP, sort of a doubling down of sending the world a message that they can and will very well move on without the United States, and that if the United States would like to continue to be engaged, it's in their own best economic interests. Renewable energies, that sector is one of the largest job creators in the US. Renewables are competitive in terms of their capacity for generating electricity, in terms of their price, with fossil fuel-based energy in several OECD countries now. And so the world is indeed different than it was 15 years ago. And so words like irreversible and unstoppable were being used more and more after the US election at the meeting than before. And so there was sort of an extra moment of solidarity amongst countries and civil society to show that we will continue to move on. And so I think despite the sort of the potential disruption that the US had, we definitely did see that a lot of people walked away from Morocco saying, yes, there's still momentum for climate action. This is going to move forward. Now, the second area is just going to move much slower. It's doing this operational rule book. What does it mean to report? Who reports? How often do you report? And these things, it sounds boring and it sounds terribly pedantic, but it matters. What you report tells us how well we're doing in terms of emissions. And so what's in and what's out of some of these rules really matters. How do you measure how much finance a country mobilizes from private sector? No one actually has tackled that question, and they need to figure that out. Other things they were looking at were, how do we get together every 5 years and have what's called a global stock take? It's a political moment where in the aggregate, everyone takes a look and says, how are we doing on mitigation, reducing our emissions, on adapting to climate change, on providing support to developing countries, and what do we need to do more of? And we need to decide, what will this look like? Will it be a bunch of presentations, which is pretty boring? Will there be technical reports? What information will be public? And so I know all of these things sound extremely boring, but they really do matter if we're going to make meaningful climate policy. And they also can be, all of these details can be extremely political. If you can make the rules work in your favor and all the counting work in your favor, that's a good thing. And so there was all of that work which they agreed to actually accelerate. The downside of the Paris Agreement entering into force is that they have to finish their work a lot quicker than they thought they had. The agreement starts in 2020. They thought they had until 2020. Now they're saying they'll finish it by 2018, which is ambitious. The rule book for the Kyoto Protocol took 3 years, and they're giving themselves 2. This year doesn't count. They didn't do a lot. So they gave themselves essentially 2 more years to do work. They also gave themselves more work to do because this first sort of governance body of the Paris Agreement, the CMA, it had work it was supposed to do at its first meeting. They're not ready to do that work. I mean, they thought that this thing would open maybe in 2019, certainly not in 2016. And so decisions at that CMA, that governance body, were supposed to take just haven't matured yet in terms of discussions or agreements or even writing something down. So they had to kind of suspend the CMA, keep it technically open, and then they'll come back and review. So what we're hoping will happen is that next year they'll come back, they'll see how they're doing on all these operational rules, and then they'll take some decisions if possible. So some countries were very much pushing to have a few decisions taken next year, whatever's ready. Other countries were saying, no, we're going to wait until 2018 because they want a package. And what they're doing by saying a package is leaving it open that there can be a little bit of trading. You know, build a little flexibility in here. So I'm okay with this if you give me this over here. And some countries absolutely do not want to see that. They're worried that that will lead to watering down some of the operational rules. And some countries are saying, let's just be realistic. That's frankly how we're going to do this. So that's sort of an ongoing conversation. We'll see how it trickles out. So that this governance body for the Paris Agreement will meet next year. No one's actually really sure what they're going to do yet because they haven't agreed if they will have decisions to agree on. And then it'll meet again in 2018 and hopefully then be ready. And all of the rules will be ready to go. So Morocco managed to advance this technical work sort of in fits and starts. Some areas are a little bit easier to figure out for countries than others. Some issues will be really difficult, like a compliance mechanism. What happens if a country doesn't meet its obligations under the Paris Agreement? And that is just going to take the full 2 years to figure out. So it's one of these things where you kind of measure progress on these technical details inch by inch. It's going to creep forward. So I think in terms of how well they did on advancing some of these rules, they actually did quite well. All of the areas where they had technical rules to work on, all of them inched forward. For all of them, there will be some sort of a public process where countries will submit or publicly make available their preferences, their positions and views on all of these items. And in several cases, there will also be a publicly transparent workshop on them. So hopefully it means that we're going to continue to progress, because Morocco was certainly a good start to the work.
Great. Thank you very much. Tzeporah.
So I had a very different view.
So one of the really, I find, fascinating things about the COPs is that besides the formal negotiations, all the countries meeting and negotiating all these details, it also ends up being basically the largest climate conference in the world. So there's 22,000 people there. And while there's the country and their delegations, it's also the world's leading climate scientists, all of the big banks and people who are involved in financing energy, the big fossil fuel companies, the energy companies, civil society groups, NGOs of all stripes, youth delegations. Of course, Aboriginal people and big delegations of both Indigenous folks from many places around the world, but then international bodies, so international associations and organizations. And if you haven't been to a COP, one thing you might not know is that while there's the negotiations that go on every day, there's also two other forums. And in this particular COP was the Blue Zone and the Green Zone. And the Blue Zone was all the formal side events that are accredited by the UNFCCC. You have to have a badge to get in there. And those side events are, every day the list comes out and it's, probably about 30 pages long. So hundreds and hundreds of events. And then there's the Green Zone, which is companies and organizations who are not accredited but are working on climate change solutions or mitigation or adaptation, and they have their, it's like a big conference hall. They have their booths and they have their own side events and presentations and panels. And so it's almost like hundreds of simultaneous conferences, literally conferences. So there was the low carbon conference put on by the climate group, and We Mean Business, 5 days of events and panels specifically on countries and companies are doing the work to meet their NDCs. And then there was a transportation conference on the best new innovation in transportation, et cetera. So it's huge and in some ways chaotic and always, in my experience, totally fascinating and exciting. And what happens in those outside places influences the negotiation and the dialogue, and the dialogue influences what civil society is doing in those kind of side events. So I wasn't involved in the negotiations. I was more involved in a lot of the development of the side events and my work on 100% renewables, and then an academic piece of work that I'm doing on trying to understand supply side policies. So I want to give you a window into both of those pieces because I think they're really relevant. But I'd say first, overall, I think I found that COP 22 specifically, this is probably, I don't know, my fifth or sixth COP, and in some ways I was surprised that I was incredibly inspired by what was happening at COP. There was a complete shift and change in the conversation and dialogue and the potential for change, which I hadn't really expected, so I was very inspired. And I would also say that COP 22 also really broke my heart. Like it just, there are, so I'm gonna start with the bad stuff, and then I'll go to the, I'll end with the inspirational good stuff, because that's always better to end that way. Okay, so why am I saying COP 22 broke my heart? I met one day with the Canadian Youth Climate Delegation. I love that they organize themselves, so there's, you know, I think it was 20 or so youth from across the country who were there tracking the negotiations and trying to make sense of them and going to all these external things. And what was fascinating to me is what they were trying to understand is the disconnect we're reading in the newspapers. How is it that we can be saying we're going to decarbonize this century and we're committed to this, you know, NDC, you know, with these dramatic reductions in emissions, and even that we're committed to 80% by 2050. So those are all commitments our country has made. Our country has also said that we want to ensure the world stays below 2 degrees with an ambition of 1.5 degrees. So I'm sitting with the youth and they're saying, but so how can we be doing this? And our government is here giving all these big speeches about how they're committed to doing this, and they're about to approve Kinder Morgan, and they've already approved this big LNG plant, Petronas, and this, none of this is making sense to me. And it was so hard to sit with them and try and give them hope, because I think there was hope in Marrakesh. And at the same time, I think that there is this tremendous disconnect right now in the policy environment and the infrastructure approvals. And that was that's a piece of work that I'm doing that is called in the literature kind of supply side policies, or the, and so in very brief, this whole system from Kyoto to now, to Paris and Marrakesh, was built on trying to analyze what each, and reduce what each country burns. So that's through demand side policies. So carbon taxes and vehicle emission regulations and building regulations, all the things you'll hear about today from the First Minister's meeting, those are demand side policies. They're designed to reduce the demand for fossil fuels and reduce how much we burn. But now we know that we have a carbon budget, that there's only so much carbon that we can take out of the ground and produce. And we know how much that is. And that's only in the last couple of years that we've really understood the carbon budget, that scientists have started to estimate what we can produce. And what's fascinating and also disheartening and frustrating is that there is no room in the UNFCCC process, or even a conversation domestically, to account for supply-side production. So we don't even as a country say how much we're going to produce in terms of fossil fuels. And that's why Norway and Canada can say we're climate leaders and we're going to meet our NDCs by reducing how much we burn, but we can still export tons of fossil fuels and increase the production, because we're only responsible for production emissions. We're only responsible for what we burn. And 80% of the emissions, certainly from oil sands, come from someone else burning it somewhere else. So the theory behind all of this is that as we develop demand-side policies and create these agreements in Paris and beyond, that the market will take care of supply, that we'll get a high carbon price, and therefore that will constrain production. So countries aren't responsible for reducing how much they produce, because the markets will decide. And you hear a lot from Alberta and from the oil industry, well, we should be allowed to compete. People are going to produce oil and gas and coal, and we should be allowed to compete. And as long as countries are reducing how much, every country is reducing how much they burn, we don't have to account for how much we produce. So that's an essential dilemma in this whole process, because there's a time lag between when demand-side policies are going to be strong enough and when our NDCs are going to be strong enough to constrain production. And it's not going to be quick enough, I don't think. And I think we're seeing that in the numbers. So while I think there was tremendous, a tremendous breakthrough in Paris and great work done in Marrakesh, the fact is that our NDCs, what each country commits to, adds up to, depending on your analysis, 2.7 degrees or 3.5 degrees warming, and not well below 2 degrees. And so I would say, well, the other thing that really broke my heart in Marrakesh is not having any plan or forcing countries to up their ambition in 2018. You know, I was really hopeful that countries would have to refile their NDCs so that we could actually have plans that meet our level of ambition, which is 1.5. But right now, we didn't achieve that. So there's conversations in this facilitative dialogue, but there is, we're not even committing to create plans according to our level of ambition, which is below 2 degrees, let alone have some accounting and accountability for the supply side, for the production side. So there's this big disconnect. And I think we're seeing that in civil society with the opposition to new fossil fuel projects, and I certainly saw it from the youth. The other thing that I would say is every COP, and specifically this one, because the changes in our environment are so quick right now, quicker than anyone thought, going to all the side event panels where there's the release of the scientific reports, it is heartbreaking. I mean, it's one thing to read a report when you're sitting at your cozy desk in Vancouver. It's a whole other thing to be at the panel of the Adaptation Africa Agricultural Initiative. It's a panel I dropped into on a side event. And you know, speaker after speaker from various countries in Africa, you know, pounded the table with tears in their eyes and said, adaptation is not a luxury. This is not a question. It's not a negotiation. Our people are dying. And we don't feel that or see it as much in Canada. But, you know, I went to presentations of scientific reports that said on current trends, Africa will produce 50% less food by 2030. So that's 14 years from now, the continent of Africa will produce 50% less food in current trends. And the implications for that, that the panel were exploring, were overwhelming. That land degradation now affects 1.5 billion people. I went to a food and agriculture panel put on by the Food and Agriculture Association that said their estimation of what we have left in the soil globally is about 60 growing cycles. And I, you know, for me as a mother, thinking, well, what do you mean we have 60 growing cycles of food left on the planet? What does that actually mean? So there's this disconnect between all the scientific, you know, pieces that are going on that just really break your heart. Okay, so on the good stuff and how I was inspired. Honestly, I had this funny experience where I got on a plane when the election, the vote was just coming in. And I live in a progressive bubble enough that I thought it was impossible that, you know, I thought, oh, you know, it's, I don't need to, it doesn't matter that I'm on a plane during the election. We all know what's going to happen. I landed in Casablanca and I was asleep, and over the plane announcement, I heard the pilot saying something about President-elect Trump. And I thought it was a joke. Like, I, you know, I'm like half asleep and I'm a turn to the, did he just, I mean, that didn't really, that really happened. And it was this bizarre thing to walk in that day to the UN negotiations, and it was like 20,000 zombies. Like, it was this weird, weird energy and weird feeling. And everyone was like, where are the US delegates? Turns out they were locked in their hotel rooms for 24 hours. Because they weren't allowed to come out of their hotel rooms for 24 hours after the election, because clearly the White House didn't want them in the press cycle. But so it was this, like, no one could find the U.S. delegates and what was going on. And I had this, like, what am I doing here? Like, the whole world has changed. How does this, how can we even make any gains in Marrakesh? And the next day I went to the panel that was a press conference from the Chinese government. And it really, it changed my whole view of what was happening, what's happening globally, because they, speaker after speaker, just said, whatever President-elect wants to do, if the US is going to slow down, good for us, then we're gonna become world superpowers, because it's clear now that the finances are there for renewables. The prices have dropped so quickly. The technology is so apparent that we're moving on. And we will continue to commit. And it, we don't care what the U.S. is doing in some ways. And it was like, it was incredibly strong statements from China. And then right after that, I went to a presentation by some of the world's largest banks where they also said the same thing. They basically said the drop in price is relentless. It, in many countries now, large-scale renewables are cheaper than fossil fuels. The finance is there. The tipping point has happened. The world is moving to renewables. And a couple of days later, 48 countries, the Climate Vulnerable Forum, became the first, well, not the first, because a couple of other countries had already done it, but so 14 countries had already committed to go 100% renewable. They were like, you know, real leaders, Denmark and others. During COP, 48 countries, all the countries that are being hit the worst, so Bangladesh and Kenya and, you know, 48 countries stood up and said, we are committing to 100% renewable energy. We are going to move to 100% renewable energy. And that, you know, for someone who's been following this now for well over a decade, I've been a part of the 100% renewable campaign now for about 8 years. And when the first COP that I went to where we talked about 100% renewables was at Copenhagen, and people laughed. We couldn't get a 100% renewable event as part of the formal process at UNFCCC. We had to be at a side event that was outside the conference because everyone was like, 100% renewable isn't even possible. You people are slightly crazy. And now here we were. I facilitated and moderated an event that was a 100% renewable campaign event that was co-hosted by the UNFCCC and the COP presidency, endorsed by some of the largest banks in the world, and had speakers from the presidents of countries, mayors, the mayor of Oslo, and the CEOs or CFOs of IKEA and Mars, and you know, the day before, the Google had committed to 100% renewables. So it was. The shift is real, like it's happening. So we have now 60 countries who have committed to go 100% renewable. We have 300 cities with Vancouver in the lead, I would like to say. Whole islands like Sumba in Indonesia, this fascinating experience where it's a cooperative that supports local communities, that is a joint cooperative with corporations and regional governments and municipal governments. And the entire island has already gone 100% renewable. 80 corporations have now pledged to go 100% renewable, and thousands of smaller companies. And so that I left Marrakesh with a lot of hope, because the momentum is there. We now have the financial circumstances and the technology and so many big commitments. And the final piece that really left me with hope was the filing of the mid-century strategies. I mean, many countries, Canada and the US included, filed mid-century strategies. And what those are is their first take at a strategic plan of how to get to 80 to 100% by 2050. And so before, kind of the 2050 goal was kind of just talk. And we were getting these mediocre commitments around what's happening now. And oh yeah, by 2050, we'll have solved it. But now they're actually putting pen to paper, and we actually have the first draft of a plan from Canada of how to, and from the US and many other countries, of how to get there. And I think that's extremely significant, and it's going to set the groundwork for the gathering next year and in further years. I'll stop there.
Thanks very much. I think we will go to the audience for comments and questions, but I'll also ask each of you if you want to ask the other one, and we'll just kind of blend that up in the conversation. Let me make sure, is this microphone's working? Angela has the microphone for people who want to use it. I'll make a comment while just signal to Angela for comments and questions. There were, as both Jennifer and Tzeporah have said, these events are huge. I reckon that the actual blue zone from the entrance point to where you were probably working must have been about a kilometer to walk.
1.2.
Yeah. I mean, they are unmanageably large. So a couple of the rooms that I was in, I was following what cities were talking about. Cities had a very strong presence in Paris, particularly led by the mayor of Paris, who convened a meeting of approximately 1,000 mayors. A little less focused this time, although there was a day-long event for local municipal leaders going on outside. What there was noticeably and relevant for Canadians, because Canadians were strongly represented, was a very strong movement of provinces and regions. And that got a lot of uptake, particularly an initiative launched by California, but with strong support by Canadian provinces and by lots of other parts of the world, called the Under 2 MOU. So representatives from the state of California spoke about that. Yeah, that was reflected in the final wrap-up event on those mid-century strategies, which you just referred to, Tzeporah, where the chief French negotiator, Laurence Tubiana, who was hosting that, said that this was one of the real surprises and most encouraging things to see subnational governments making mm-hmm. pledges and commitments. And of course that has to be read against the political context of the United States, but of course not only in the United States. And it was interesting at that final wrap-up event, speaking for that group of now 130 regions, it was the Environment Minister of Quebec who spoke. So Canada was well represented there. The Canadian delegation in large was at least almost as large as it was in Paris. The Canadian government hosted a reception for that. You and I were both there. You were probably working somewhere else, but you were invited in spirit. It was extraordinary, the range of people who were there, from the youth delegates who you were talking to the Minister of Environment, Catherine McKenna, provincial premiers, people from major corporations, think tanks across the country, and a great geographic spread. I had a chance to talk to folks in different parts of Canada I rarely get a chance to see. So it's nice to see that, coming together, notwithstanding the very distinct differences of aspirations and ambitions among people from Canada who were there. So that's a little context relevant for today, what's going on in Ottawa in the First Minister's meeting. And I'll be happy to take comments and questions on how people want to think about how to piece together these very different perceptions of the state of the world where we're at and what was happening last month. Does anyone want to lead us off? Well, I'll actually invite one of you to speak. Tom, actually, good.
Sure. Thanks. I'm Tom Green. I think there's an underlying tension here that explains some of these things. For me as an ecological economist, all our commitments are committed to ongoing GDP growth into the indefinite future. And to deliver that GDP growth, the easiest thing to do is to do things like build pipelines, extractivism generally. Now, of course, we know that clean technology can deliver a lot of jobs and so on, but it's the usual tap that countries and politicians use to deliver GDP, and also things like building highways and so on. So it's partly about a mind shift, and I'm wondering if you want to talk about that.
It's partly about a mind shift, but it is also, I think, a failure in part of the climate community writ large, or the low carbon community writ large, in not proposing specific infrastructure projects and investment alternatives. Because sure, clean energy can increase jobs significantly, that's right. It's also predominantly infrastructure that is government funded. And so when we talk about the need to invest in public transit, to address transportation emissions, and a lot of the other, buildings and retrofits, et cetera, these are big ticket government budget items. Whereas when the fossil fuel industry talks about a new pipeline or a new oil sands operation, this is private capital coming into the country. And I think that is a huge problem in how we shift our thinking around infrastructure. I don't believe that looking at other countries who are reducing emissions really quickly and even our own province, that necessarily it has to be that the problem is we can't increase the GDP. I think we probably can. But I think for Canada specifically, one of the big problems is we keep looking at reducing the fossil fuel industry and increasing clean energy. That's one of the issues. But the bottom line is we are not going to replace fossil fuel exports from this country with electricity exports. And so it's not, we need to shift to renewable energy and electrification for our own consumption, but that's not going to address the financial issues in the country, because in fact it's about that we export so much. And what replaces that revenue? What replaces that investment? What replaces that infrastructure? And I was excited to see your report from IISD on kind of the, recently they did an economics report on kind of the Commonwealth Canada's, what Canada has as potential new or existing economic pieces that we can invest in. I think we need to really drill down on that in BC and in Alberta to figure out what are our competitive advantages that we should be pushing, because it's not just clean energy and clean tech and high tech. We have to figure out what our future looks like if we're going to be reducing significantly oil and gas production and exports. And I think one of the big barriers to that is the fact that the fossil fuel industry continues to promote expansion of the industry as being okay, because we can still meet our NDC. I think what we'll hear today is we can't. I don't think we can meet our NDC, and that the government's going to start looking to buying international credits in order to do that. And I hope that both civil society and the academic community will stand up and say that's not good enough. We need to, at the bare minimum, meet our NDC, but we also need to be looking at how we're shifting away from producing so much fossil fuels for exports.
Do you want to just explain the term NDC?
National determined contribution. That's what each country, it's what each country has to, how much they have to reduce, how much we've filed saying we can reduce. And to be clear, our NDC, our Canadian NDC is based on Harper's targets, which our Prime Minister said were too weak and was the absolute floor of what we're going to do. But I think we'll hear from the First Minister's meeting today that it's going to be quite an ambitious national climate plan, but we're not going to meet our NDC.
Hi, my name is John Tack.
Yes, it's working.
Probably here.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
It's working. My name is John Tack. In terms of renewable energy, where does BC's Site C dam fall in terms of available, dispatchable renewable energy?
So there have been a number of studies that looked at the potential for smaller scale distributed renewables that could produce as much as Site C and would actually benefit more communities. Not going to remember who produced that study off the top of my head, but I know it's been peer reviewed and there's a new one that's set to release within the next couple of weeks. It's a difficult question because if you just look at the numbers, if we're going to go 100% renewable, for example, in British Columbia, and that includes transportation, that means demand for electricity is going to skyrocket in the province. And a lot of the analysis that I've seen between now and 2050 says that we would need it all. We would need all of the proposed, a lot of the proposed run of river projects. We would need Site C, we would, et cetera. Some of the new studies coming out say that no, we can meet them, we can meet our own demand simply by distributed renewables. I'm not sure. Most of my work has been based in Alberta the last couple of years, so I haven't looked at it closely enough. I think from a human rights perspective and from ecological impacts perspective, Site C is a disaster. I read the environmental assessment. It was very, very poorly done. I read the scientific report that was produced by a number of academics here critiquing that environmental assessment. I think it was an inadequate environmental assessment. And I think the fact that Site C is currently being built or prepared to be built while there are still treaty lawsuits in court is just reprehensible. So it's complicated. That's my 5 minutes on Site C.
Sure.
I think it's also worth mentioning that hydro dams and hydropower are not actually emissions free. So there's been a growing amount of scientific evidence that show that emissions from so-called flooded lands equal perhaps the aviation sector globally. So it's about 2%.
And so the IPCC has now started to do some of this work to look at that literature, and that will take a little bit of time for them to do, but it'll be in their next assessment report as one of the special reports around methodologies for inventory. So again, how you count the numbers matter. And so BC may have a huge new source of emissions that they never counted on, and that they certainly don't have a plan to reduce.
There's a great deal more that could be said on that topic, but we'll move on to other bigger picture issues. Go ahead, Jacob. Please do continue to introduce yourselves for the audience.
Thank you. Joseph Pallant, Brinkman Climate. I was made very happy by seeing the formal announcement of an intention to use international credits as part of Canada's NDC, which was announced in Paris and reiterated today, because of the role that they have in creating a real price disincentive to the country to not meet its internal targets. So I think that saying, oh, they're just going to buy international credits, they're getting off easy, is not necessarily the right way to look at it, because they're having to ship money to pay for emissions reductions elsewhere, which maybe would be better done here, but I think also good elsewhere. I wonder, Jennifer, if you, or Dr. Allan, if you could tell us more about the role that international credits under Article 6 of the Paris Agreement can actually act to bind the countries and the signatories together. I know the first half of the talk was about Marrakesh and the whole UNFCCC framework and how that transfer of international emissions rights can actually really bring us closer together in this time of discord.
Sure. So Article 6 of the Paris Agreement is about markets and market mechanisms, so-called cooperative approaches is sort of the new euphemism that we're putting on this, the new name for them. And what they're trying to do is come up with an international way of one country saying, I have an internationally transferable mitigation outcome. In other words, I reduce my emissions by this amount, which I can sell to another country. And so you're creating a global market, is the idea that the price of that ITMO, because every COP needs to create a new acronym, the cost of that ITMO will be determined by supply and demand globally.
ITMO is
internationally transferred mitigation outcome. They also created MPGs, modalities, procedures, and guidelines, because they got tired of saying that. So that's the intention behind it. And this has a long conversation at the UN process. I think in 2011 there was an agreement to have a new market mechanism. There already are market mechanisms under the UN process, like the Clean Development Mechanism, for example. This was something that was agreed to in the Paris Agreement as a package, and it was something that several countries really demanded would be there, particularly developed countries who said, look, if you want us to be more ambitious, we need to have the flexibility of markets. And a bunch of developing countries said, actually, we just need you to be more ambitious and reduce your emissions, rather than trying to buy our emissions reductions efforts off of us. And so there's two very different and contrasting logics at play with this. And because it's so difficult with these creating these operational rules around these Article 6 market mechanism, it's moving centimeter by centimeter. So at this meeting, there are three sort of main areas of negotiations under Article 6, and there was such strong demand that they all be dealt with in a balanced way because they were agreed to as a package, that they came up with three identical decisions that at one point, one delegate said, if as much as a comma changes here, the whole deal's off. And after all of that, which was also an all-nighter, which I will thank them for later, all it is, hey, in May, why don't everybody just tell us what you want to see in this and we'll have a public sort of submissions of views. And that was 24 hours of negotiation time to come up with that. So I think this is one area, and this is something maybe I'd be interested in Tzeporah's views. This is one area where I think the rest of the world is just going to outpace the UN by leaps and bounds. When China's national cap and trade system comes online in March, 60% of the world's GDP will be covered by a carbon price.
Yeah.
So whether or not you like carbon prices, whether or not you prefer tax or cap and trade, the UN system is going to move really slowly on this, and subnational action and national action is clearly just going to outpace, I think, whatever the UN comes up with.
Tzeporah, do you want to
add? Yeah, no, I think that's true. I think that the fact that it's going to take a while for the UN to come up with the rules, et cetera, I think speaks to this meeting this NDC with domestic actions. And if we're going to increase our level of ambition, as we've said, to be equivalent with 1.5, if Harper's targets are truly a floor, then let's meet those targets with national ambition to reduce pollution and maybe consider, you know, ITMOs in the future, that, you know, to increase our level of ambition. But that's what I was responding to there. But I do agree that at a national and on a subnational level, we're seeing so much movement on carbon pricing that it really is going to outpace what the UN is doing. There's going to be deals. I mean, there already is, right? Between Ontario and Quebec and California, and we're going to start seeing, I think, quite a lot of trading.
Can I ask both of you, again, as a observer, having been to these things only twice, how much actual, I mean, interaction, or where does the interaction happen between the official process and what's going on in the side events and the external events at a COP? My guess is that the all the, you know, the side events were originally created so that delegates could go and educate themselves on certain topics in between negotiations, and there was expected to be, you know, kind of a education process back and forth. It doesn't work like that as much anymore, just because of the sheer scale of everything, including the complexity of the negotiations. But in terms of a building of momentum and a public opinion and informed public opinion, and through all the fantastic amount of media, informal blogging networks, products like yours, the various networks you would have been communicating on, they do have an interaction, but it's hard sometimes to figure out. It probably doesn't occur in the same place at the same time. It probably jumps along at different scales. Any observations about that?
You know, I'd say one overarching thing, which is what we have to remember, is that ministers, prime ministers, presidents, negotiators, they're just people. Yeah. They're people, and they're influenced. You know, I can't say who it was, but I had a funny experience in one of those, you know, those big bathroom areas in between the formal negotiations and the green room. And I'm in the bathroom and I hear a minister who I knew the sound of their voice saying, well, but did you read that press release from blah, blah, blah? We're going to look bad if we're both. And I said, I feel like I should tell you, I'm in the stall next to you. But so they're reading the press releases, right? I went into the Canadian delegate's office at one point to talk to one of the ministers, and they had the ECO, you know, the civil society newsletter that's put out every day, you know, posted on the wall. So when 48 countries come out and commit to 100% renewable, it's not a formal part of the negotiations. That has nothing to do with the negotiations, but it impacted the negotiations because it's a level of ambition. Countries' positions are political. They don't want to look bad. They want to position themselves a certain way. It's a constant back and forth.
Yeah.
And what, especially with the under 2-degree MOU and the subnational means like provincial and state governments and what they're doing, what the cities do and what the provinces and states do has a big impact on what the countries can do. Like, I can guarantee you Canada wouldn't have been in Paris saying Canada is back and being so ambitious if Alberta hadn't just passed a climate plan, because they wouldn't have had the license to do it, because the predominant growth in our emissions was coming from Alberta. So what cities and provinces and states do has a big impact on what the negotiators do and what the countries do. And so it's, you know, I saw a constant back and forth. I don't know if you want to comment on that.
And then we've got a Twitter comment, and then I think we'll
sure.
conclude.
I think also, it's now more of a back and forth through the media, through public or through informal channels, between having networks that involve delegates or ministers. It used to be much more direct, and it used to be that states would host their own side events to say, hey, we have this framework for how to have an equitable distribution of emissions targets that we want to tell everybody about. And so now I think we've actually reached this size where that's no longer possible. Delegates used to be in the side events all the time.
And now it's really difficult to get them. Their schedules shift constantly at a moment's notice. And so there's a bit of a disconnect there. It's not as direct of an interaction. But absolutely, I mean, they will, even in negotiations, they will refer to press releases. Mm-hmm. Or they will come to each other and say, hey, have you seen this? Because this is an issue. Or the fossil of the day that Climate Action Network does. I've had country delegates come up to me saying, how did they find out that we said that in that room? You were in that room. Did you tell them? And so they care. Public shaming matters. And whether or not you think that's a great strategy, it's one that can work. And I think the other reason why side events are so useful is there's an incredible depth of information that's communicated. Mm-hmm. And so if a delegation, I mean, we're talking about these huge delegations like the Canadian one, we're not talking about necessarily the Kenyan one that probably had 15 people that was supposed to be covering 20 meetings at any given time. Mm-hmm. And so the depth of information that civil society brings is extremely useful to delegations that need that expertise. And it's another sort of back and forth that you see between the blue zone and the green zone.
Mm-hmm. We'll take an online comment, and I think that'll be our last for this session. Please.
Okay, there's actually two comments.
Great.
Or questions here. The first is, how important do you feel air capture of CO2 and biomass with CCS, are they going to be to keep us below 2 degrees? And the final comment, which I think might be a good ending note, is question, what are some of the most effective things Canadians can do now to help further climate action, for example, as consumers or academics?
Do either of you want to respond?
Should we
start? Well, give both of you the mic on both.
So on the first, I think this is sort of under the rubric of what we call negative emissions. So what are things that can suck carbon out of the air, sort of bluntly put? The IPCC, again, will be doing a bunch of work on this at the request of the UN process, because there's a lot of work that's showing that we can't hit 1.5 without these sort of negative emissions. And one of the messages that some countries, especially large emitting countries, want to get across quite loudly is, are you actually willing for the scale on which that will happen? We will need to be planting forests on the scale of, say, the country of India, and how are we going to fund that? Will that lead to land grabs? Are we sure that this is what we want to be doing? And so 1.5, I think if we have any hope of it, we will have to use those negative emissions technologies. And there's sort of a growing chorus of scientists saying it's an all hands on deck approach. If you want to put in CCS, start doing it. It's you know, asking the horse to come in after you've already let them run out free, but that's where some scientists think that we're at. Do you want to do one question at a time?
Why don't you just, if you've got a comment on the last one, yeah, and then I'll just pass to Tzeporah.
Sure. In terms of what Canadians can do every day, this is sort of, so I also teach this with my students, and I run into this problem where do I tell my students, you know, make sure that you yourself are personally responsible, you know, cut down on your beef consumption and use public transit? Or do I teach them there's only so much you can do as an individual, and at some point we need systemic change, whether you think that is in our political system or our economic system or both? And so there's the usual shopping list of 20 things you can do to reduce your impact on the environment, which probably most people have seen. But I think there's other things we can consider, like how hard do we want to push for proportional representation? So countries with PR have stronger green parties and better environmental records. How hard do we want to push our government to say, or our banks, when we go in and do investments, actually, I want fossil fuel free investments? So what questions are we as individuals willing to ask to sort of the bigger structures? Beyond, you know, the 20 things that you can do to, you know, weatherproof your house and take the bus. So that would be my question. Just think about questions that you can ask that might be slightly uncomfortable, but raise some more interesting questions down the line.
I don't know much. I haven't researched much on biomass, but I will say one thing on air capture, which is that you know, surprisingly, technological air capture, air sequestration is working. And it's not the same. I'm not a big fan of many of the big geoengineering fixes, but there is newly an air sequestration plant in Squamish, one of the first in the world that's producing carbon pellets. I went to the opening of it. It's been designed by David Keith out of Harvard, Canadian, and it's just sucking air, and sand goes in the bottom, and the carbon attaches to the sand, and out comes carbon pellets. Those can be made into a park bench or gas, right? It's just carbon. It's solid carbon. And I was quite shocked because I thought, well, it's not by a coal plant or something. How is this working? And David Keith turned to me and said, because no matter where you go now, Tzeporah, it's 400 parts per million, which was... I'll never get that conversation out of my head. But so fascinating, right? And we're going to need it. The numbers show we're going to need it. It's not viable economically until carbon is about $110, $120 a ton. So right now, it's just a pilot project. But the fact is, it's fascinating. It works. You can just filter air and take the carbon out again.
Sorry, I'm going to have to interrupt it because we're at the end of time.
The Squamish people have a slightly different take on it.
Okay, I don't know who that means because I've met with the mayor and the regional district and the MLA. But
business manager.
Yeah. If we could just let Tzeporah finish.
I'm happy to talk to you about it after. And so just on what can Canadians do? We don't have time for this to be about whether or not you ride to work or change your light bulb. We don't. This is the decisive decade. At the point that we hit 450 parts per million, we could ban all cars in Canada and it wouldn't make a difference because we've lost too much sea ice. And at that point, changes in our climate become unavoidable. So the next 10 years matter. They matter a lot. And we have the technology to do it now, but it's not about changing our light bulbs, it's about changing our laws. So while lifestyle changes are important, especially as a mom for teaching our kids, I think more important is teaching them that they're not just consumers, they're citizens. So if you haven't written to your MLA or your MP, you should. If you haven't called them up, you should. I call them up frequently. I just have it in my calendar, like part of my diary. Call your MLA, call your MP. They hear from me all the time. Because they work for us, right? We're voters. They work for us. And they need to know that we care about this. And I can guarantee you they're hearing on a daily basis from all the fossil fuel companies and the pipeline companies how much they care. And that is critical. That's how democracy works. It doesn't work if you're not engaged. So this is about voting and telling people you're going to vote according to those values. It's about engaging with your elected decision makers as often as you can and supporting the groups who are doing the hard work to really understand the issues and lobby on our behalf. And I think that there's some amazing groups in Canada who are doing that work. The Pembina Institute, Environmental Defense, and Clean Energy Canada is doing some great work to lobby on climate laws and regulations, especially in BC and Canada. And then, but find the group that you believe in and engage with them. Don't just write the check. Find out how you can support them. Here in British Columbia, I think that's even more important. We're entering into an election year. We have a premier that has taken us back on climate policy quite significantly. We used to be leaders in this province in addressing climate change, and now our emissions are going up, not down. Our emissions are going up almost faster than any other province except for Saskatchewan. So while Alberta's emissions are now going to peak and go down because of their climate plan, as a result of our climate plan, our emissions will go up for the next 15 years in British Columbia because of Premier Christy Clark. So, there's an election coming up. So if you live in British Columbia, I would say this is a pretty important year for the climate. Thanks.
Thank you so much. If you'd like to thank our two presenters today, thank you for coming.